talk show.
Recorded live.
Hello, everybody. This is Jörg Lissmann once again from YouTube channel Juggler66, and I welcome you all to a new episode on Hour of the Truth. Today we have July the 2nd, 2015, and it's only 2 days until Americans get really crazy and really wild because it is Independence Day, and they are having a big feast on a independence that wasn't an independence, but that put them right into Roman Catholic slavery. And this is what we are talking about today. Christians and Babylonian politics. America's founding fathers blasphemed Jesus Christ. You may not like the title, but you may not like the truth either. The truth doesn't care if you like it or not. It is there. The truth is what it is. Wake up, deal with it. Secondly, I wanted to mention my brother in Christ, Tom Press, who is doing a wonderful reading at this moment on Inquisition Update that you can all follow weekdays, 8 o'clock in the morning at this time. When you watch my videos, it's announced in there. You can see that. He does a wonderful reading of the book The Global Vatican, written by Francis Rooney, who was an ambassador to the Vatican from the United States between the years 2005 and 2008. And people like Francis Rooney have a lot of knowledge about the things that we are talking about here today. He has a lot of knowledge about the hidden founding fathers that we were talking about earlier, like the Carols. And Tom Press has made it his work to read that book online, and as far as I know, there are, for the moment, I think 10 or 11 parts out, and I have that uploaded on my second YouTube channel that is called Juggler's War on Disinfo, in one word, and I have uploaded 3 parts already, and there are some people who watch this, and I want to thank you also, YouTube channel Adam1984, because he also copied not only a lot, many of my videos, like the characteristics of Antichrist and other stuff, but he also mirrors the reading from Tom Press on the Global Vatican. And I can advise anybody who's listening to this broadcast or watching this video to take a look at that and really to get into it and to understand why you are so deceived. Surely, as we are just 2 days away from this big Independence Day, and all the patriots come out on the streets and have their fireworks and have that party, and you know, I give it to them. Let them have it all. But understand one very important thing. You, the people, everywhere, not only in America, are patriots, but your leaders only swear allegiance to one kingdom. And that is the kingdom of the Antichrist, with the king sitting on the throne in Rome, in Vatican City, the Pope, the biblical, historical, and prophetic Antichrist. They do not pay any allegiance to any country they work in. That is the big difference between the peoples inhabiting the countries and the people ruling these countries. So study this, and when you are aware of this, then you probably will stay inside the next 4th of July and just mourn about the Protestantism that has gone through the ages and really needs a revival right now, because everything otherwise is going down the drain. So today, as other days also, my co-host will be Walt Stickel from the fantastic website granddesignexposed.com. He has prepared something that he wants to introduce you to first, and then afterwards we will continue the reading of the Vatican Jesuit Global Conspiracy booklet that Walt put together. And in the meantime, I'm just asking, Walt, how are you doing over there in Romerica, 2 days before the wonderful Patriot Day of Independence Day? How's it going?
Well, I'm gathering myself, and I'm contained. Well, you know, I'm a little hesitant here that, you know, the people that are going to listen to this in the archives, you know, The title is Christians in Babylonian Politics, America's Founding Fathers Blaspheme Jesus Christ. And you know, I've got to lay a little foundation before we start here. This is probably the most sensitive nerve on Americans. It was the last, to get rid of my patriotism, that was the last thing on the agenda with me. I mean, first of all, I had to repent that I was in the papal army, because America has been fighting papal wars ever since its beginning. And World War I and World War II was a papal war. Korea was a papal war. Vietnam was a papal war, and all the wars in between. So
Don't forget the Civil War, Walt.
Yes. Oh, yes.
Don't forget the Civil War.
Yes.
Very important.
Yes, that was another papal war. That was a counter-reformation. And so you know what I find interesting is I had an email sent to me here, and I want to kind of go over it to lay the you know, this is a quote from a Manly P. Hall. Not only were many of the founders of the United States government Masons, but they received aid from a secret an august body existing in Europe, which helped them to establish this country for a peculiar and particular purpose known only to the initiated few. Now, that was Manly P. Hall. And the secret and august body that helped establish this country were none other than the Jesuit order. And there's a picture that's passed around in the patriot community of George Washington getting baptized by John Gano. It's a painting, understand? It's a painting. And he's got his hand up above the head of George Washington. It can be, you can see this, just John Gano baptized, and you baptizing Washington, and you can find this on the internet. He's got his hand up over Washington's head with the sign of the Roman Catholic Trinity. Okay. And then an email was a friend of mine sent this to me. And I'm not going to read the whole thing, but it goes like this in one paragraph. Said, we are not to be a part of the evil governments. We are to fight against them. To not do so makes you part of them by your passiveness. You cannot go with their flow, because this is surrendering to the evil and becoming part of it. What you do not oppose, you accept. If you do not oppose the mark of the beast, means you will accept it. Anyone who does is done for all eternity. And right now, they are implanting people via the evil, deadly vaccines, and the people and babies don't even know it, because they are going with the flow and are passive and not involved in the events all around them. Now, this email is making some good points, but this is where it goes awry. These people accept every lie DC tells them to believe, and that is everything since DC has not told the truth to public opinion since 1865. Now, it's a little bit of truth in there, but the government hasn't told the truth since 1776. What you don't fight, you accept. It's simple as that. And the founders never blasphemed the Lord. Now, this is what our broadcast is about. Americans founding fathers blaspheme Jesus Christ. Now listen, I have another one I want to bring this to our attention. This was sent to me. This email was sent to me And it started out like this. I'm not going to put any names in this, but this is the mechanism. There's an army of Americans that have this kind of opinion, or that's their freedom of conscience. Okay, that's what they believe in. You know, it was sent to an email. I was sent to a party. We were discussing this 1776. And so I said, one thing we both can agree, and this pertains to this broadcast, see. One thing we both can agree on is the American Revolution gave civil and religious liberties to Catholics. And history tells the rest of the story. Who benefited from the American Revolution? 2015 tells us the answer. Okay, the answer I got was, I will say that the Enlightenment opened the door for the founders to be indoctrinated into the Luciferian idea that all religions are equal. Well, the hoarder took that and run with it. No, I think the whore started it, because understand the Enlightenment came out of Voltaireism. Voltaire was a Jesuit. All of the founders, and if you, in a great document, is the hidden faith of the founding fathers. Now, I want you to listen to the hidden faith of the founding fathers one more time. And you take a pencil and paper, and Chris Pinto will connect every one of those founders with the Jesuits. Just do your own research, listen, and you'll see exactly what I'm talking about. The Revolution did allow opportunities for the Jesuit-led papacy to make inroads, but it also created the greatest enemy, the armed property-owning Protestant American middle class. Americans and people that are listening to this, they love the guns, the Jesuits. When they unplug this, it's going to be chaos, and people will be killing each other, and they have no idea who their enemy is. But this man has his right to freedom of conscience. He says, nowhere in the world is there such a dangerous population, even as conquered as we are. Europe wouldn't dream of putting up the resistance we are capable of if the sleeping giant awakens. Remember, the Pope is coming on the 23rd, a Jesuit Pope of September of this year. I answered back and I said, I stayed right on target, you see. All I did was state a fact. Okay, and I stated the fact again. I said, I made it a little bit clearer this time. I said, we can both agree that the Catholics got civil and religious liberties because of the American Revolution. That is just a fact. The First Amendment assured that right for all Americans, including the Catholics. So really, they did get civil and religious liberty. That is just history. Who benefited from 1776? History tells us the answer. You don't want my opinions. Look at the history and connect the dots yourself. Now, this is the reply I got. Now, I want to explain. You've heard me mention postmodern thinking. And that was given to us by the Jesuits, by the way. But what is a postmodern? They will intimidate and then give false accusations. They'll give you a false accusation to intimidate you, to suck you in. Now, this is the answer I got. Now, listen to this. You've heard all I've said. Understand, I'm not trying to run anybody down. This is a textbook example of postmodernism. He says, Walt, you get testy and double down if you like, but then I'll walk away. I think that's a threat, wouldn't you? He's threatening to walk away. He's intimidating me. The second thing he says, there's an ugly side to the agenda you and York push, which is to throw the baby out with the bathwater. Think of that. I'll give you that Washington was cozy with the papists. I'll give you that the founders failed to protect their Reformation birthright, probably due to the Enlightenment. I'll give you that 99% of the revolutions are top-down. They're 100%, okay? The American Revolution was top-down. It was financed by Charles Carroll. He was one of the biggest financiers. He worked with the banker that's up in the rotunda. I forget this fellow's name right now, but he was right in the middle of this. But I will not give you anything that hates on all of America as being owned by the whore from day one. Let me explain that. This country has had some great people in it. And we have produced like no other country. Why? Because 50% of the Americans got German blood in them. I've heard 46, but I'll round it off to 50. Doesn't matter. I'm not talking about a particular group, but there was Frenchmen, Dutchmen, English. And they came over here because of religious persecution. And they were able to get a piece of ground and they were able to harvest their crops and sell them and benefit from their own labor. This country prospered. I flew across this United States in 1977 in a 150 Cessna. I've got a bird's eye view of America. When you go across North Dakota, you see piles of rock. They didn't have bulldozers. They had large families, and they had horse and wagon, and they picked up the rocks, and they cleared the land, and they grew wheat, and they grew 10 acres one year, and they realized if we just double it next year, we can make twice as much money. There was an incentive. There was an incentive. And it wasn't because of the United States government. Government never produces anything. It breaks everything up. And to be in love with the United States government is being in love with Babylon. Now that's where this country was great. I'm 50% German. My grandfather and grandmother raised 7 children. And I'll tell you about them 7. Every one of them knew how to work. What built this country was European work ethics. And they were free. And they got away from the religious persecution of the Roman Catholic Church. And that had to be broken in 1876. They had to break the ties with Protestant England. Now listen, this country and the Constitution of the United States and the Bill of Rights There's nothing wrong with it, except they've overturned it. 6 out of the 9 chief justices in this country are Catholic. And only last week, they legalized sodomy. This wonderful, great country. I mean, I said that wrong. Strike it. This wonderful, great government. There's nothing wonderful and great about this government. And we're going to get into this on the later broadcast. But I'm not done on these points. He said, York is a typical European and doesn't like that America is the sole superpower, whether we're being run by Rome or not. What your angel is, I don't know. This is militant. This person that wrote this is militant to the core. And Roman Catholicism is militant. Just look at history. And what built this country was the Europeans. And he's attacking a man he's never even talked to. And he says, I'm a man of real solutions now, not to sit back and wait for Christ to return. Let me repeat that. He said, I'm a man of real solution now. Not sit back and wait for Christ to return. He wants to solve the problem, doesn't he? We are commanded to occupy to that time. And because your view doesn't have saving solution for this wonderful country of ours, your value is a failure. No, my Savior is not a failure. This is a perfect, and the reason I'm going over this point by point, this is a textbook example of postmodernism. He said, I'm sensing you have bitterness, issues that you're wrongfully projecting here. Recognize it. Turn them over to Christ. He wants me to turn this over to the United States government. And listen what he says. Be healed and join me because join me. Join me. I'm not asking you to join me. I want you to join God's kingdom, Jesus Christ. Because when Christ returns, he has a solution. And we're to hold on until that happens. And because if you insist on join me, because if you insist on being just an anchor and not a propeller, we will part ways. Another threat. I raised a daughter with the same kind of mindset. I'm 71 years old. You don't think I've seen this behavior before? This is why this is a very important broadcast. Because we're getting ready down to the nitty-gritty. And we're going to talk about the mechanics, and we're going to talk with evidence. You see, it's like this too. I've met several authors. People that write books, they want to sell the book. Okay? So they got to promote the book. And then they have an agenda. They have an agenda with their book. That doesn't mean all books are terrible. When you're writing a book on patriotism, or don't strike that. I mean, it doesn't matter what book. Then after they write their agenda, they will give up their life to defend it. Now, there's a difference between the book, and by the way, I had a chance to send one to Denmark. I've sent them all over the United States. One is in Israel. One is in Japan. Now, the difference between the book that I've offered and printed, the Bible says to buy the truth and sell it not. And you can go up to the internet and you can download it and you can go have it printed yourself. I like to have something in my hand. But beware. Beware of these book writers. Be cautious. I mean, there's hundreds of them. Why name? I don't want to name names. It doesn't matter. There's an army of these people. This little email, you don't think I haven't got this kind of a response before? But I didn't know how to answer it. I'll tell you how I answered this. I disengaged. Because this man wants me to engage with intimidation and false accusations. It's so simple when you see the mechanics of this. And they're like a bunch of cockroaches. When you turn the light on them, they scurry to the corners. So, let's get started. Let's get started on this. This was urgent. I wanted to go to the back. I put this in the back of the book. Because I want to say briefly, you don't have to read the introduction. I want to introduce this article. I wrote a little introduction in the book, but I want to introduce this man that wrote this. I did not write this article. I was communicating with a young man. He was about 35, 36 years old, and he was a school teacher. His name was Scott. And he taught United States history in the Fort Worth, Dallas area. And he was a tremendous researcher. Some of the material he came up with. And anyway, long story short, he fell off the radar. And I got one more email from him. I always used to tell him. And I'd always tell him, when even young men today, the thing I said, be wise as a serpent. You know, we're amongst raving wolves. Be wise as a serpent and gentle as a lamb. Because they want to tear you piece by piece apart. Anyway, he got fired. I don't know the circumstances, but he was a family man, and you know what that does to income and finance, and I never heard from him. But this article, you watch the founding faith of the founding fathers by Chris Pinto. This is equivalent to Chris Pinto's writing, and Chris Pinto did an excellent job in putting the founding faith of the founding fathers. So his name is Scott. Wherever you are, Scott, if you happen to hear it, God bless you. But here's Scott giving us the nitty-gritty. The down-to-earth, what our founding fathers are all about. No, I'm not bitter. I'm very thankful that my eyes have been opened and my ear, you know, and I've got ears to hear. Because it clears all this up. I have to admit, listeners, it kind of stings to think that the Supreme Court passed and legalized sodomy. It stings. I think of the work. This country has been great. And it was the people that made it great. The government, when you look at the foreign policy of America and the atrocities that this country has done under the guise of freedom, but that doesn't change the people. That don't change my grandfather and my grandmother. They were morally sound people. And they were good citizens. And law doesn't make people, you cannot legislate morality. That's what made this country great. But not these founding fathers. They planted the seed of destruction. And they've been working against us from get-go, from 1776. This is where it started. The American Revolution was counter-reformation. That's not my agenda. In the American Civil War was counter-reformation. They've pounded this country for a couple hundred years and completely pounded the protest out of this country. And to think that some people think that we're going to take this country back. I know a fellow that's got a talk show call. It's called Restoring America. Restoring America. You're not going to start with the government. The solution is Jesus Christ and the perfect sacrifice. That is the solution. One other thing that this fellow said in another email, he actually said this, and I'm telling you, brothers, it hurts my soul. I'm not angry at this man. I'm 71 years old. I'm old enough to be his father. And the only difference between him and I is I've made a lot more mistakes. Because I've lived longer. And he's been fed a lot more propaganda than I have. And believe me, I've been fed some. I sent a link to Pope Benedict's the 16th celebrates the 200th anniversary in America. You know, I sent that link. That's all I did. You know, that's all I sent. I got answered back. He said, Rome insinuated herself into the revolution, but I don't see that she was behind it. Remember, 6 out of the 9 chief justices in 2015 are interpreting constitutional law, and they legalized sodomy. It wasn't the Protestants that did it, okay? There's still the percentage of people in this country are not sodomites, and they're not representing us. Rome insinuated herself into the revolution, but I don't see that she was behind it. They fomented the revolution. I will say this. We got more than we were supposed to get, okay? They started off with just trying to give us the Constitution, but there was a lot of infighting, inroad. And listen, the American Revolution was not popular. But the 4th of July now, shoot the fireworks up, it's popular. No, it was not popular. But this is the one that I have pain for, this brother. I'm not angry at this brother. But this was the hardest pill for me to get rid of. And it's called patriotism. I am a patriot to the kingdom, God's kingdom. I'm a child of God. My king has been elected. We know the winner. And we know the loser. We are the winners. He said, she has worked to take us over. She, meaning the whore, has worked to take us over since that time. What he means by time is 1776. And is nearly complete. But we are capable of throwing her off, and we will. Now, it's like this. It's like this. God's people, I'm always cautious with anybody with an M16 and has this agenda. This is very militant. I see no place in God's word that we're to take up arms. I see no place. It's not there. Christ could have leveled this earth at the time of his ministry. He didn't. And so that's my introduction to the start of this broadcast. It's almost took 45 minutes, but it's real important. Now, let's go and read and get the facts about who the founding fathers were. Okay, York, I'm ready.
Okay, Walt, thank you very much. But I want to go into one point that you mentioned. He said that he denies that the Roman Catholic Church was behind the taking over. He denies that the Roman Catholic Church was behind the taking over of America from its inception. And I have very acceptable proof that he is wrong there. And that acceptable proof I read for a part in the book Rulers of Evil. In the chapter, I think it was chapter 7, The Fingerstroke of God, when Ignatius of Loyola presented the false oath of induction to the Pope to get his okay to found the Society of Jesus. And in this oath, there are a lot of interesting sentences, but there is one sentence that makes it very clear that the Jesuits were formed at that time to directly intervene in the new continent of America. And that quote goes as follows. Therefore, to the utmost of my power, I shall and will defend this doctrine of His Holiness's right and custom against all usurpers of the heretical or Protestant authority, whatever, especially the Lutheran of Germany, Holland, Denmark, Sweden, Norway, and the now pretended authority and churches of England and Scotland and branches of the same now established in Ireland and on the continent of America and elsewhere, and all adherents in regard that they be usurped as her anti-heretical, opposing the Sacred Mother Church of Rome. So here you see that already in 1540, by introducing this oath to the Pope to found the Society of Jesus, they were determined to go into the continent of America and usurp it for the Roman Catholic Church. And I thought this was quite an interesting point to start with. So
it is a very. I just want to add to that. That's actually that is the sole purpose of the Jesuits. The sole purpose was to counter the Reformation, and that in other words,
all levels.
On all levels, and to think that the Jesuits weren't involved with the American Revolution is just not true. It's just not true. I mean, they never, they're relentless. There were three Jesuits that went over on the Ark of the Dove and landed in 1634. You know, and there was more than just the three. That's the three we know of. And one of them, Andrew White, was taken back in chains when they caught him. They took him back to England in chains, and he died in England. I mean, they didn't speak like, listen, when they knew, and one thing that I want to bring out here, you see, all the constitutions of the states and the colonies there, of the original 13, including Maryland. Maryland was the government, because of the royal Glorious Revolution, they were still ruled by Protestants. And the reason for it is that it was fresh in their mind. It was the only place. Listen, what makes America great is the fact that here was 13 colonies, and they were free of the whore that was that keeps people poor all over the world. There's no reason for Mexico to be as poor as they are. They're poor because of the Roman Catholic Church. Same as South America. They're just held down. They're held down.
Walt, there's a reason why they call it Latin America.
That's a good point, too. You know, yes, you know. And you know, I noticed we didn't have too many live listeners, and there's going to be some in the archives, but this is not popular. This is not popular, but let it be known. I don't have any sugar daddies. I have nobody supporting me. Okay. I don't have to answer to any man, and I won't. I'm ready to die. You know, and eventually, we're going to see. Who's behind this when the veil's taken off? You know? So I think that's a good point. It's a very good point. I mean, I have a lot of empathy for these patriots. I mean, they're loaded to the gun. They have their guns, their AK-47s, and I even heard one of them say to this. They said, you know, the only 4% partook in the American Revolution, and that's true. It wasn't popular. It was not popular. The first terrorists were the patriots. I've got a page up there. I did a research page on the loyalists. I didn't know there was loyalists. And yeah, I mean, they would go up and down the out in the country and pull up to a farmer's house and say, are you with us or against us? Have you heard that one before? And if they were against them, they'd burn their house down. They did it with death.
In all totalitarian states, you hear this question. Yeah. It's a little bit like George W. Bush asking the questions. He put it a little bit different. He didn't put it into a question. He said, you're either with us or with the terrorists.
That's it.
Whatever the United States government calls terrorists, classifies as terrorists. When today you speak the truth, which is the word of the Bible, the word of God, you are a terrorist. You are a religious fundamentalist. It doesn't matter if you say the truth. Because truth is the new hate speech. You should really get it.
Yes, truth is the new hate speech.
And I will now start reading in the booklets, the Vatican Jesuit Global Conspiracy. Sorry, I have to say that by heart. And so many books in my head, I sometimes forget. the Vatican Jesuit Global Conspiracy, and I will read from page 111 on. Christians and Babylonian Politics. America's Founding Fathers Blasphemed Jesus Christ. About 4 years ago, I severed myself from politics. I don't care who is president of the United States, Israel, Britain, or any other country. Christians should not be concerned with these things because we are supposed to be called out and separate people. Politics is a spiritual Babylon, and the political systems of men are not going to save us. All the rulers of this earth are wicked and have rebelled against God. What fellowship has the light with darkness, as in 2 Corinthians 6, verse 14, quote, "Be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion hath light with darkness?" Unquote. And from Psalms 2, 1 through 6, it reads, quote, "Why do the heathen rage, and the people imagine a vain thing? The things of the earth set themselves, and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed, saying, Let us break their bands asunder and cast away their cords from us. He that sitteth in the heavens shall laugh. The Lord shall have them in derision. Then shall he speak unto them in his wrath and vex them in his sore displeasure. Yet have I set my king upon my holy hill of Zion." End quote. Most Christians can see that America is sick and dying. Yet for some reason they think, quote, "If we can just get a good conservative Christian into office, everything will be all right." Unquote. Christians need to understand that government doesn't work. The entire system is built upon deception and is corrupt beyond repair. The corruption and deception was ushered in when the revolutionaries set things in motion in 1776. We cannot serve God and mammon at the same time, as stated in Matthew 6, verse 24, which goes as follows, quote, "No man can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. Ye cannot serve God and mammon." And that was Jesus Christ speaking in Matthew. Christians continue to look in the physical world for solutions to spiritual problems. Our King is the Lord Jesus Christ, whose kingdom is not of this world. John 18, verse 36, Jesus answered, quote, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, then would my servants fight, that I should not be delivered to the Jews. But now is my kingdom not from hence." Unquote. We've heard a lot in recent years from Christian leaders about America getting back to the Constitution or getting back to the Founding Fathers. Yeah, getting back to the Constitution. That's Ron Paul, his creed, isn't it? Did you know that Ron Paul was more than 10 times in Rome? Did you know that Ron Paul gave speeches at Jesuit Georgetown University? Because things were more godly back in those days, so they say. Understand that Christians cannot back to something godly if it never was godly to begin with. The movers and shakers of the American Revolution were not Christians. They were in bed with the occult. These men were products of the Enlightenment era. Their God was, and still is, the God of reason. The American Revolution and the Constitution opened the floodgates to the destruction of the biblical communities that had been established in the original 13 colonies. That's why the Constitution was put in place, to destroy biblical Christianity and pave the way for utopianism and the God of reason. The Constitution gave us an occult, Freemasonic, and universal government that allowed for all other religions to come in and swallow up Bible-based Christianity that at one time existed in the colonies. Sorry. The men who set the American Revolution in motion were occultists, and they had an occult agenda. In short, their aim was to secularize the entire world and bring about a utopian world government built upon man's ability to conquer all things by way of the human intellect. This is the polar opposite of living a life for Jesus Christ. After the American Revolution and creation of the Constitution, numerous antichrist religions flourished and biblical Christianity was subverted by doctrines of devils, Catholicism, that were purposefully injected into the churches. Romans 6, verse 23 reads, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." End quote. And 1 Timothy 4, verse 1 states, "Now the Spirit speaketh expressly, that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils." Unquote. I'm not saying that the Protestant colonists were correct in forming Christian-based communities with Christian-based laws that alienated Roman Catholics and other religious groups, nor am I advocating a Christian theocracy in the United States now that does the same thing. A Christianized government, as advocated by Christian dominionists today, is not the answer. There is no political solution for the Christian. Our solution is in Christ alone. I will repeat that. Our solution is in Christ alone. Our hope is not in this world or in government. And we were never given any guarantees from God in the scriptures that we would always live in peace in this world while under the governments of men. The life of a true believer and follower of Jesus Christ is one of persecution. Christ told us the world would hate us because it hated him first. Matthew 10, verse 22, quote, "And ye shall be hated of all men for my name's sake, but he that endureth to the end shall be saved," unquote. And John, verse 15, 18, and 19, quote, "If the world hate you, ye know that it hated me before it hated you. If ye were of the world would love his own. But because ye are not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hateth you," unquote. I realize that we have enjoyed relative peace in this country for a long time, and I'm grateful to God for that. But it's crucial to understand that the utopian America or utopian world is just not what the Bible tells us is going to ultimately happen. The powers that be may create a seemingly utopian kingdom upon the earth for a time, but it will never last. When they say peace and safety, sudden destruction comes upon them, as mentioned in 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 3, quote, "For when there shall peace and safety, then sudden destruction cometh upon them, as travail upon a woman with child, and they shall not escape," end quote. The American empire is going to fall, eventually, just as all empires do. And when it does, those of us who are alive to see it must be able to stand on faith alone, as there will be no other form of salvation outside of Jesus Christ. Remember, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and nobody comes to the Father except through me. I'd like to demonstrate exactly what our so-called founding fathers believe. For Christian church leaders to stand up in the pulpit and say that we were founded as a Christian nation is absurd and provably false by examining the historical record. As you read below, the original writings of the men who formed this nation, think carefully about what spirit guided them. And we start mentioning Thomas Paine. That's something I would have done if he wouldn't have done it. He wrote The Age of Reason, isn't it, Walt?
Yes, he did.
Paine's thoughts on the Bible, in contrast to his creator, which is none other than the God of Freemasonry, the God of reason, human intellect, which is Lucifer. Quote, "When I see throughout the greater part of this book," and he means the Bible, "scarcely anything but a history of the grossest vices and a collection of the most paltry and contemptible tales. I cannot dishonor my Creator by calling it by his name. Thomas Paine, From the Age of Reason, page 21. Paine denies the divinity of Jesus Christ and says the gospel is obscene. Listen to it himself. Page 138 from the 1898 edition. Quote, "It is the fable of Jesus Christ." The fable of Jesus Christ. "As told in the New Testament, and the wild and visionary doctrine raised thereon, against which I contend. The story, taking it as it is told, is blasphemously obscene."
Comment.
Yeah, please.
Yeah. Well, I just want to comment. You just have to ask the question, is this man a blasphemer?
Of course he is.
You know, I mean, in other words, let their own words answer the question.
I mean, when you write about the fable of Jesus Christ, what is that but blaspheming? Because that's denying the divinity of Christ. That's denying Jesus Christ was here. That means when it comes to the end, he will teach another Jesus. He will teach another gospel. Of course, that is blasphemy at its best.
And let's go on, because I think it's important to cover this, because, you know, we'll just talk, because this is right from their mouth, okay?
We can always interrupt for a little discussion in between. Walt, I love that, no problem, but I'm sure he will go on reading now.
Okay, go ahead.
Paine attacks the virgin birth of Christ. Quote from page 171. "What is it the Testament teaches us? To believe that the Almighty committed debauchery with a woman engaged to be married, and the belief of his debauchery is called faith." Unquote. Paine elevates the God of reason, Lucifer, human intellect, above the body of Christ. Quote, "I do not believe in the creed professed by any church that I know of. My own mind is my church." That comes from page 6. And here you have a prime example of self. I am God. We are all gods. We are all our own gods. This is exactly, in other words, what Thomas Paine says here, on page 6 of the still 1898 edition of Age of Reason. Paine declares that the word of God is demonic. Would you believe that? Let's see. He states, quote, "It would be more consistent that we called it the word of a demon than the word of God." Unquote. This comes from page 18. Paine's blasphemy continues. Quote, "I, Thomas Paine, of the state of New York, author of the work entitled Common Sense, which awaked America to a declaration of independence, author also of a work lately published entitled Examination of the Passages in the New Testament, quoted from the Old and called prophecies concerning Jesus Christ and showing there are no prophecies of any such person." Unquote. And this comes from the writings of Thomas Paine, collected and edited by Moncure Daniel Conway in 1896. Paine declares Christianity is a fraud. Quote, "The Christian theory is little less than an idolatry of the ancient mythologists, and it yet remains to reason and philosophy to abolish the amphibious fraud." Unquote. This comes from the Age of Reason again. And this ends the reading of Thomas Paine in this book. We will continue with Thomas Jefferson after Walt gave us a little bit more insight.
Well, I just want, you know, this is painful to even read.
Oh, yeah.
This is painful to even read, but it's the truth. It's evidence. And you see, in postmodern thinking, evidence doesn't matter. And so when they disagree with evidence, they either intimidate or a false accusation. And the Jesuits are, have perfected casuistry and sophistry to cover up this. I can't think of that one man. He's a Mormon. What was his name? His last name is Beck.
Do you mean John Beck?
No, he traveled. His last name is Beck. I can't think of his first name, but he was working for Fox News for a while, but he even traveled. He traveled about, and he even actually was passing out the Age of Reason. I mean, like I said, this is painful, but I said to myself, this is important, especially in the age that we live in right now, in 2015, and with what's transpired the last couple of weeks. So anyway, let's get on to Thomas Jefferson.
Okay, Jefferson gives his assessment of the author of and book of Revelation in the Bible. Quote, "It is between 50 and 60 years since I read it, and I then consider this as merely the ravings of a maniac, no more worthy nor capable of explanation than the incoherences of our own nightly dreams." Unquote. Thomas Jefferson in a letter to General Alexander Smythe, January 17, 1825. Jefferson put together his own Bible called Jefferson Bible, in which he took out certain passages of Scripture while throwing out the rest, considering it as dung. Quote, "The greatest of all the reformers of the depraved religion of his own country was Jesus of Nazareth. Abstracting what is really his from the rubbish in which it is buried, easily distinguished by its luster from the dross of his biographers, and as separable as the diamond from the dunghill." Unquote. Thomas Jefferson, letter to William Short, October 31st, 1819. Interesting that he chose Reformation Day to write this letter where he blasphemes Jesus Christ in this way. Don't you think, Walt?
Yes, it's no coincidence.
No, surely.
It's no coincidence. I mean, and this, it's chilling to even read this. I'd like to say that this wasn't true, but, it's a fact. And that's why anytime you hear, and there's a whole army in this country, it's, and I don't want to name any names, okay? Because it's no sense naming names, because there's an army of these people that think they're going to restore America or turn America back. In other words, the founders, this country was founded, and there was nothing wrong with the Constitution and the Bill of Rights, but it was founded to do exactly what they've done. And now it took them a couple hundred years to completely devastate the Constitution and the Bill of Rights, but we still have a little bit of freedom of speech. And I tremble sometimes when I think of what I just said the first 45 minutes, but it's the truth. You see, it is the truth.
Why shouldn't you speak the truth, Walt? Why should you tremble from speaking the truth?
Well, because I realize how few of us are. There's so few that people want to, and the only way they can deny it is they have to intimidate you with a false accusation. You see, I mean, they want to tell us that all these revolutions were, started by the Jesuit, except this one. And this was no different. In other words, you can't take away what was happening, what was happening. They had to break Protestant England away from these colonies, and you brought up earlier that it was right from the founding of the Jesuits, their goal is to destroy the Protestant movement. It's not a it's It's right there in history. And I guess I get a little sometimes overwhelmed when I see this, how evident it is and how few people want to accept it. Because you have to accept the responsibility of the truth. The same way when you read God's word, you have to accept the responsibility. Once you know the truth, the more truth you learn, the more responsibility you have. And I can't be part of joining with somebody to promote a lie, you know. So, you know, let's finish off Jefferson.
Jefferson blasphemes the account of the Ten Commandments in the Bible. Quote, "Where get we then the Ten Commandments? The book indeed gives them to us verbatim, but where did it get them? For itself tells us they were written by the finger of God on tables of stone which were destroyed by Moses. But the whole history of these books is so defective and doubtful that it seems vain to attempt minute inquiry into it, and such tricks have been played with that text, and with the text of other books relating to them, that we have a right from that cause to entertain much doubt what parts of them are genuine." Unquote. Thomas Jefferson in a letter to John Adams, January 24, 1814. That's a little before the Jesuits got reinstalled, I think, because it's the same year, 1814. In the same letter to Adams, Jefferson continues, quote, "In the New Testament, there is internal evidence that parts of it have proceeded from an extraordinary man and that other parts are the fabric of very inferior minds. It is as easy to separate those parts as to pick out diamonds from dunghills." Thomas Jefferson in the same letter. Jefferson escalates his position by blaspheming against the words of Jesus Christ recorded in the scripture, saying that some of what Jesus says is all right, but that other things spoken by Christ are worthless. He then goes on to call the Apostle Paul a fraud. Quote, "Among the sayings and discourse imputed to him, I find many passages of fine imagination, correct morality, and of the most lovely benevolence, and others again of so much ignorance, so much absurdity, so much untruth, charlatanism, and imposture. I separate therefore the gold from the dross, and leave to the stupidity of some and roguery of others of his disciples. Of this band of dupes and impostors, Paul was the first corrupter of the doctrines of Jesus." In a letter to William Short, April 13, 1820. So that was 4 years before what we read before. Jefferson wrote a letter to his nephew, warning his nephew to examine the scriptures through the filter of human intellect, meaning the God of Freemasonry, of course. Note how Jefferson challenges the supernatural aspect of Christ pertaining to the virgin birth and Christ's ascension into heaven. And I just want to say here, there's a saying that goes, wisdom of the world can never understand divine matters. And what is he doing? With the wisdom of the world, with the enlightenment of Lucifer, he is going to examine divine matters, and that does not work. But of course, people love it when other people tell them things and fall for it, and they rather fall for man than they fall for God. Note how Jefferson challenges the supernatural aspect of Christ pertaining to the virgin birth and Christ's ascension into heaven. Quote, "You will next read the New Testament. It is the history of a personage called Jesus. Keep in your eye the opposite pretensions. One of those who say he was begotten by God, born of a virgin, suspended and reversed the laws of nature at will, and descended bodily into heaven. And two, of those who say he was a man of illegitimate birth, who set out without pretensions to divinity, ended in believing them, and was punished capitally for sedition by being gibbeted according to the Roman law? These questions are examined in the books I have mentioned. They will assist you in your inquiries, but keep your reason firmly on the watch in regarding them all. In a letter to Peter Carr, August 10, 1787. One sentence really jumps into my eyes here. They will assist you in your inquiries. Where does it say that here? These questions are examined in the books I have mentioned. No. Ah, where is it? It was such an interesting thing to read here. I cannot find it now. Okay, I can find it. I'm just going on for the reason of going on here. But I'm sorry I lost it. Maybe I have time later to read it again, read over it, and then make my point of this. Jefferson wrote to Adams that he desired for the gospel to one day be replaced by the ancient mystery religion, the same God and religion of Freemasonry, here in the United States. Note how he denies God manifested in the flesh in Christ. Quote, "And the day will come when the mystical generation of Jesus, by the Supreme Being as his father in the womb of a virgin, will be classed with the fable of generation of Minerva in the brain of Jupiter. But we may hope that the dawn of reason and freedom of thought in this United States will do away with all this artificial scaffolding and restore to us the primitive and genuine doctrines." End quote. Thomas Jefferson in a letter to John Adams, April 11, 1823. Jefferson writes that he doesn't agree with Jesus on all of Jesus' doctrines, specifically on salvation through faith. Jefferson argues that salvation comes through deeds, very Catholic and Freemasonic, rather than through faith and repentance. And then I end with a quote from Thomas Jefferson in a letter to William Short, April 13, 1820. I'd like to know if that was Friday the 13th, you know. Quote, "The character of Jesus, it is not to be understood that I am with him in all his doctrines. He preaches the efficacy of repentance towards forgiveness of sin. I require counterpoise of good works to redeem it." End quote. And this concludes the reading of the role of Thomas Jefferson.
Thomas Jefferson wrote the Declaration of Independence. He was the main writer of the Declaration of Independence.
So how can you call the Declaration of Independence or the Constitution of the United States of America a Protestant paper when you know that someone who was that much influenced by Freemasonic and Jesuitical teaching wrote all this stuff? He is a denier of Christ. Is a Protestant a denier of Christ? Is that the new explanation that I missed out somewhere? When reading through all these points that I've just read to you, you cannot possibly leave this room with the understanding, oh, they were Protestants. They were followers of Jesus Christ. They upheld the Bible. When you read this, you see how their thoughts really are. And then they use, and I think this is something we haven't mentioned yet, they use Jesuitical casuistry to write the Constitution of the United States of America and the of Independence.
The Bill of Rights, but the Bill of Rights,
Bill of Rights, yeah.
The Bill of Rights, you know, that's for the principles. There were some in battles with the Federalist Papers, you know, but all these founders were, you know, they were very wealthy men, and you know, I mean, we have been told about these founders and as their icons, like their gods. And to speak anything against them is like to speak against God. And here they've deified Washington up in the – but we'll get to Washington. But But no, it kind of takes your breath away, because listen, I'm 71 years old, and you know, it's hard to get rid of this old information, and it's real easy to get hopped up on misinformation, and look what happened as far as patriotism in history. Look what happened to Germany, the Third Reich. They were very patriotic. You know, and patriotism is a tool that the Jesuits use. You know, and now they're breaking all that down. When they bring in multiculturalism, and trying to mold everybody together to drop all that. See, I mean, so anyway, not happy. This is not happy news, but this is the truth. This is exactly why we, in other words, when you understand what happened last week in passing and legalizing sodomy by the Supreme Court, you know, I mean, it's where was the seed for this? Six out of those nine chief justices prior to 1776 couldn't even hold office. They couldn't hold any office. And now they control the government and the Supreme Court. They interpret the Constitution. You know, there's not one Protestant in the Supreme Court.
And even if there was a Protestant on the Supreme Court, he would probably be Jesuit educated, like all the pastors of the so-called denominations, the so-called Protestant denominations in the United States of America are. But I just want to go back here to the letter that Thomas Jefferson wrote to Peter Carr in 1787, because I found the point that I was just looking for. Quote, "They will assist you in your inquiries, but keep your reason firmly on the watch in reading them all." Keep your reason firmly. So when you read the New Testament, he advises to keep your reason firmly. And this is absolutely contradictory, because the Bible explains itself. I don't need human reasoning to understand anything of the Bible, neither the Old Testament nor the New Testament. And he advises to keep your reason firmly on the watch in reading them all. That's the point I just wanted to make. I'm sorry I didn't find it at the moment.
And that is a good point. I mean, that's Freemasonry.
At its purest.
Yes, that's Freemasonry. The Freemasons, you know, they've infiltrated all these ecumenical churches, and that's just, I mean, they do not believe the Bible. You know, I mean, you know, and you know. So anyway, let's get to Ben Franklin here now.
Okay. Franklin elaborates on his faith in a letter to the president of Yale University, only 1 month before Franklin's death. In the letter, he says the divinity of Jesus is a trivial matter, and that he doubts Jesus was divine. In essence, his doubt is a confirmation of denial, because a person either believes or they do not believe. Quote, and this is taken from Carl Van Doren, Benjamin Franklin, New York, The Viking Press, edition of 1938, page 777. Well, there must be some truth in this, with 3 times 7, huh? Quote, "As to Jesus of Nazareth, my opinion of whom you particularly desire, I think the system of morals and his religion, has he left them to us, the best the world ever saw or is likely to see. But I apprehend it has received various corrupt changes, and I have, with most of the present dissenters in England, some doubts as to his divinity, and I think it needless to busy myself with it now, when I expect soon an opportunity of knowing the truth with less trouble." Unquote. That was Ben Franklin. You want me to continue with John Adams? Walt?
Yes, yes. Let's get.
We go into John Adams.
Because in other words, too, a lot of these patriots will say, "Well, John Adams was a Christian. See, they'll try to say,
well, we will see this, and we will disprove this while we are going through this reading.
This book. I mean, these quotes answer the question: was John Adams a Christian?
Okay, we can see if we can find the answers in this text here. John Adams elevates the occult Masonic God of Reason over the Word of God while denying the supernatural and Word of God in the Bible at the same time. Quote, when philosophical reason is clear and certain by intuition, or necessary induction, no subsequent revelation supported by prophecies or miracles can supersede it. Unquote. This is as cited in the American Philosophy, an encyclopedia by John Lax, Robert B. Tallis, page 164. Adams tells us the principles behind the American Revolution are the principles of nature and reason, which are none other than the principles of Freemasonry, the principles of New Age, the principles of Babylon, to name it really the way it is. Quote, these are what are called revolution principles. They are the principles of Aristotle and Plato, the principles of nature and eternal reason. Unquote. John Adams in Nov. Anglos and Massachusettensis, or Political Essays, page 12. Well, I find it very interesting, Walt, that he comes here to mention Aristotle and Plato. While we made a broadcast, I don't know if you were on that some time ago, on Nothing But the Truth, on Plato's Cave. And I just happened to upload this video a few days ago on my YouTube channel, Juggler66. And I advise everyone to look that out, to look that up, and see how they are using so-called reason and these principles that Plato laid down in that time. Really, really interesting to get into. That's an interesting video you should watch. Adams writes to Jefferson that he believes Voltaire and his colleagues have done more for religious liberty than the Protestant reformers Calvin and Luther. Quote, I should have given my reason for rejoicing in Voltaire and company. It is because I believe they have done more to propagate religious liberty than Calvin or Luther. Unquote. John Adams in a letter to Thomas Jefferson, December 25th, 1813.
Isn't that amazing that he says religious liberty? In other words, you know, I believe they have done more to propagate religious liberty than Calvin or Luther. You know,
this is just denying the Protestant Reformation.
It's just denying. Luther and Calvin, what they were doing is they were protesting Rome, and their mainstay was not just religious liberty. Their mainstay was the Bible. Bible and the Bible only, and you know when what most people don't understand is that what they were doing is putting Rome out of business, because you don't need a priest, and also the fact that he mentions Voltaire. Well, Voltaire was a Jesuit.
Oh yeah. He said some very interesting and even some true things, but he was a Jesuit. Yeah. Never to forget.
Yes. And it was the Jesuits that give us the word democracy, and they were pushing democracy. Well, our government was a constitutional republic.
Well, democracy is not given by the Jesuits, Walt. That comes from Greece.
Well, but Bellarmine was in on it. I was just reading yesterday. Listen, there was three...
Sorry to interrupt you here, but when I say democracy comes from Greece, that means it comes from out of the realm where the Word of God ruled in that time. Yeah. So that is, of course, humanistic thinking. This is exactly what we are dealing with here all the time.
Yes,
Democracy is nothing. Is not something God invented. It is something that came out of the heathen nations, and Greece was a heathen nation at that time.
That's right. And
they invented democracy, and of course, it was picked up by these guys
who
tried to overthrow the republic without actually overthrowing it, but
right.
to build a state in a state. A democracy within a republic, and people cannot recognize it anymore. Because normally, in a republic, you can choose anybody of the inhabitants to be president. In a democracy, you can do that also, but in a democracy, you have to understand that democracy only works in villages, in small communities. Democracy, as the Greek invented it, if I may call it that way, inventing, in that time, was not to lead a whole nation, not a nation as small as Belgium, where I live, or as big as the United States of America over there where you live. Democracy is not for a big nation. Democracy is a principle based on reason for the ruling of small communities and small cities, and not of whole states. And
yet,
what you actually want to say, if I'm not wrong, is they adapted that and put that in, and by that way undermined the Republican status of the United States of America. I have a funny video uploaded on my channel, you have to look for it, where President Obama says, "I swear allegiance to the world's oldest democracy." Look it up, it's on my channel.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Sometimes you need something to laugh,
well,
you know,
and
that's one laugh.
What they have done with the word democracy is, and they started pushing it around 1920. I mean, in this country, I mean, you know, but its roots are like you say from Greece, but it was three other Jesuits. I mean, in other words, they incorporated that, and you haven't got to that chapter where Tupper Saucy covers, you know, the Constitution, you know.
I'm a slow reader, Walt.
That's going to be covered in Rulers of Evil, in the Tupper Saucy covers that. I mean, you can see the incorporation, they couldn't do this fast. They could not excite this country because there was just too much. There was too many Protestants. But in other words, once they took the protest out of the Protestant, it was all over. And there's no protest in other words, people use the word Protestant, but they don't. They use the word Protestant because we even mispronounced the word wrong. It is Protestant. It is not Protestant.
We will continue reading on page 119 about this statement from Adams is quite revealing if one understands what Voltaire believed. So the statement that I've just read in part two, I will continue it for that you can understand it better, and then I will go to what Voltaire wrote directly. So the statement from Adams is, quote, "I should have given my reason for rejoicing in Voltaire and company. It is because I believe they have done more to propagate religious liberty than Calvin or Luther," unquote. And Voltaire wrote, quote, "Christianity is the most ridiculous, the most absurd and bloody religion that has ever infected the world. It took 12 ignorant fishermen to establish Christianity. I will show the world how one Frenchman can destroy it," unquote. He is cited like this in the Encyclopedia of Ethics by Lawrence C. Becker, Charlotte B. Becker, volume 3, page 1771. Voltaire cited in Thy Kingdom Come, Part 2, by J. Parnell McCarter, online edition, chapter 59. Adams was a Unitarian. What's a Unitarian?
I really can't give you the right the the definition. A Unitarian.
Et pluribus unum. Out of many, one. Et pluribus unum. You have that on the seal of the United States, or you have that on your $1 bill. That's a Unitarian. Unites, all make one. Building the Tower of Babel. Adams was a Unitarian. Unitarians deny the Godhead of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Adams did not believe that Jesus was the Son of God or God manifested in the flesh. Recall 1 John 4, verses 2 to 3. Quote, "Hereby know ye the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesseth that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is of God. And every spirit that confesseth not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is not of God. And this is that spirit of Antichrist, whereof ye have heard that it should come. And even now, already, is it in the world." End quote. Adams wrote, quote, "The Pythagorean, as well as Platonic philosophers, probably concurred in the fabrication of the Christian Trinity," unquote, in a letter to Thomas Jefferson, December 25th, 1813. So there was quite a long letter then, I guess. We have the second quote from there. If we are to believe what John wrote in 1 John 4, verses 2 and 3, then we must acknowledge that Adams was the spirit of Antichrist, according to Adams' own words. Quote, "The Europeans are all deeply tainted with prejudices, which they can never get rid of. They are all infected with creeds and confessions of faith. They all believe that great principle, God, which has produced this boundless universe, came down to this little ball, earth, to be spit upon by Jews. And until this awful blasphemy is gone rid of, there never will be any liberal science in the world." Unquote. In a letter to Thomas Jefferson, January 22nd, 1825. Is there something you want to say right here, Walt, or shall I go on reading? Okay, I go on reading. "The Bible tells us that we can know God through Jesus Christ. Adams tells us the opposite. Quote, "When we say God is a spirit, we know what we mean. Let us be content, therefore, to believe him to be a spirit, that is, in essence, that we know nothing of." Unquote. In a letter to Thomas Jefferson, January 17, 1820. John Adams also tells us where he gets his Antichrist beliefs, which is from Shasta, or Brahmanism. Note that Brahmanism is revered in the occult. Quote, "Where is to be found theology more orthodox or philosophy more profound than in the introduction to the Shasta? God is one, creator of all, universal sphere. Search not the essence and the nature of the eternal who is one. Your research will be vain and presumptuous. The eternal willed to communicate of his essence and of his splendor to beings capable of perceiving it. The eternal willed and he created Burma, Vitsnov, and Sib." Unquote. These doctrines, sublime, if ever there were any sublime, Pythagoras learned in India. John Adams in a letter to Thomas Jefferson, December 25th, 1813. And now we can go on and continue with George Washington, but first I want to make Walt some comments on the things that I've just read.
Well, I don't really have any comments on what you said. I have a comment of what we're getting ready to talk about George Washington. Now here is one of their sacred cows is George Washington, and I want to refer people back to the Hidden Faith of the Founding Fathers by Chris Pinto. He has a whole section. One part of his documentary is called Washington and the Jesuit Connection. So, in the fact that, you know, when I first heard this, it's in Catholic circles, but there's a good chance that, I mean, I that that you know, he was baptized. He was become a Catholic on his deathbed. I mean, that's been in papers, and it's I've seen some articles that came out of Notre Dame, and you know, but what we do know that he was a Roman sympathizer. I mean, he was a neighbor to Charles Carroll. He was neighbors to Charles Carroll, and his grandchildren went to Georgetown College at the time. I don't know if they called it a university at that time, but
it was started as an old boys' college in the beginning.
Yes, you know.
And they went to that college there. Yeah. Don't get me started on George Washington. I mean, just look up in the Capitol. Look at the apotheosis, this painting that is on the top on the ceiling of the Capitol. A Protestant would never, never, ever be deified.
Yes. I mean, that's in chapter 23 of Rulers of Evil. It'll take your breath away. I have chapter 23 up there on the internet and with pictures. And
I don't think
can you pronounce the fellow's name that painted that? He's from Bermuda.
Brumini or whatever. Yeah,
yes,
I know it is mentioned. It is mentioned in Rules of Evil already in one of the chapters that I read, and I'm starting chapter 10 now. So that has been mentioned there also. I think it was Brumini or something like that.
Yes,
but I have
yes,
to tell it from my heart because I can't read it. Yeah, I don't have it in front of me.
And he came from Rome.
Yeah, he was an Italian. Yeah, of course.
He was an Italian, and
yeah. And he was as sure Catholic as the Pope is.
and listen, I want to stop and let everybody just think of what I'm going to say here. I've been to the Capitol. I've looked up into that rotunda. But at the time I was looking up there, I didn't have no idea what I was looking at.
And if you're not at least 60 feet up, you can't see anything anyway.
Yes, like George Washington, there's about 50 the figures up there. It's huge. But the point that I'm making, do you realize what it takes to put a painting in a rotunda like that? You know, I mean, these people are serious about their religion.
I think it also took some work to lift up freedom on the dome of the Capitol in that time that they
three
did
lifts.
It.
They did
today,
it.
Today they just take a helicopter or two and put it up there, but in those times they really were determined to put freedom up there. The problem is that 99.9% of the American people do not have any idea what figure that is and what that figure stands for. That is on the top of the Capitol dome.
And underneath this court, and they deified Washington in that, you know, and there's a statue of him right there in the rotunda, you know, but George Washington was also a member of the Society of Cincinnati. I mean, he was a deist, and he was not a Christian. And of course, I'm not going to name any names, but people know who I'm talking about. I mean, he was called a Calvinist Baptist, and he was not a Christian. It's just not true. I mean, to go any further,
Well, Walt, before we slander George Washington here by just saying things, let's just keep on doing the reading.
Well,
I think your teacher friend from Texas put some things up there that speak for themselves next to the things that we've just mentioned about.
I want to say something
on the rotunda.
I want to correct you. We're really. I think I use the poor choice of words sometimes. And in other words, we're not trying to slander George Washington. We're trying to give you the truth, and that lets you make the decisions. I mean, we have covered Thomas Jefferson, Thomas Paine, Ben Franklin, and John Adams, and lets you make the decision. Were these men Christian? You make the decision. You can get this book that we're reading out of up there on my website, Grand Design Exposed. It's called The Vatican Jesuit Global Conspiracy. So So anyway, let's get back to Scott's article, the author of this article here.
Yeah, okay, I continue reading then on page 121. Washington was not as blunt as his revolutionary brothers when it came to blaspheming Christ and the Bible. However, much can be gleaned about Washington from Washington's own writings as well as the writings of the men who surrounded him. Although the Freemason Washington attended church on Sunday, he was notorious for getting up and leaving every time communion was conducted, always refusing to participate in the communion. He is also known by the clergy of the time for refusing to speak publicly concerning the Christian faith. There are also sources that claim he often slipped out of the church service on Sunday in order to attend Catholic Mass. Both Catholic and non-Catholic sources submit that Washington converted to Catholicism moments before his death. But without getting into it too much hearsay, let's examine what Washington said himself. Note what Freemason Washington writes to his fellow Freemason brother Lafayette. By the way, didn't Lafayette name his children after Washington?
At least one
of his sons, Lafayette.
But Lafayette was a Catholic.
Yeah. And he named at least one of his sons after George Washington. Washington speaks of Christianity as if he's on the outside of the body of Christ, speaking of Christians as them. Washington's personal motto was, quote-unquote, deeds, not words, which fits what he is saying here, the essence being that he merely entertains the beliefs of the professors of Christianity. This is par excellence for the men who belong to the ancient mystery schools. They may go to church in order to give the appearance of godliness, but inwardly they are ravenous wolves who deny Jesus Christ.
And also, I'd like to, Deeds Not Words, that book was written by a Jesuit.
It just said here that it was his personal motto, not that it was a book.
But there's a book, though. There's a book. That's where he got it. There's a book called Deeds, Not Words.
Well, that must be Catholic, yeah.
And Deeds, Not Words, and it's written by a Jesuit, and it's brought out in the Hidden Faith of the Founding Fathers. I'll tell you, I watched the Hidden Faith of the Founding Fathers probably three times.
I watched it twice on there.
Before it really, it was probably the third or fourth time that I watched it that I realized that Chris Pinto had made a whole segment on Washington, the Jesuit connection. I mean, that's the only one of the founders that he, I mean, but like I said earlier in the broadcast, if you listen to the Hidden Faith of the Founding Fathers, Chris Pinto does. He makes the connection. And the reason why, it's because of Voltairism, but with Thomas Paine actually roomed with a Jesuit. I mean, he makes all the connections. Every one of those founders has a Jesuit connection. You know, and that is in Hidden Faith of the Founding Fathers. And Chris Pinto did an excellent job in his research on that video. Okay,
I continue reading now.
Yes.
And quoting the Bible, Matthew 10, verse 16. Behold, I sent you forth as sheep in the midst of wolves. Be ye therefore wise as serpents and harmless as doves. Unquote. And the next quote comes from George Washington's Sacred Fire by Peter A. Lilbeck with Jerry Newcomb, page 553. Quote, being no bigot myself to any mode of worship, I am disposed to indulge the professors of Christianity in the church that wrote to heaven, which to them shall seem the most direct, plainest, easiest, and least liable to exception. Unquote. Thomas Jefferson wrote in his diary concerning the questions of Washington's faith. Before Washington left office, the clergy in Philadelphia pressured Washington to make a public profession of faith for posterity's sake. Washington denied to do so. Jefferson writes about the controversy, Note that Asa Green was the congressional chaplain during the 8 years Washington served as president. Do you have any knowledge about who Asa Green was, Walt?
No, I don't. I was going to guess that it was one of his slaves, but I'm not positive. No.
Oh, that's anyway an interesting person to look after afterwards, after we're done with this broadcast here. Jefferson writes about Washington and the subject of Washington's Christian faith. Quote, February 1st? What? Is it February 1st or what? Yeah, February 1st, probably. Dr. Rush tells me that he had it from Asa Green that when the clergy addressed General Washington on his departure from the government, it was observed in their consultation that he had never on any occasion said a word to the public which showed a belief in the Christian religion, and they thought they should so pen their address as to force him at length to declare publicly whether he was a Christian or not. They did so. However, he observed, the old fox was too cunning for them. He answered every article in their address, particularly except that, which he passed over without notice. I know that Governor Morris has often told me that General Washington believed no more in the system, Christianity, than he did. And this is taken from A Sly Old Fox, George Washington and Religion, from a talk to Teachers Institute at Mount Vernon, July 21st, 1999, citing the writings of Thomas Jefferson, Volume 1, page 284.
Note that Isaac Green, there's a note up there on the top of the page, note that Isaac Green was a congressional chaplain during the 8 years Washington served as president.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so that's who Isaac Green was.
Yeah, a chaplain, but I wanted to know a little bit more about his background. He could be a chaplain and could be a Protestant or a Catholic. He could have even been a Jesuit.
Well, at the time, the last two chaplains we've had in the House, in the Congressional House, has been a Jesuit. I'm sure he wasn't a Jesuit. I mean, at that time,
I'm just posing the question, Walt, that's all.
And one thing I want to say, you see, these founders had to walk lightly. The people in the street knew what was going on, especially when you read a little bit about, I forget the name of the minister that George Washington used to go every, and he's the one that I read that gives you a kind of a picture of George Washington and his habits, he wouldn't come on communion weekend. See, he wouldn't come, and this article said, he was a fox. He never did admit publicly that he was a Christian.
He never made an official confession of faith.
No, he never did. And of course, we know he was a Mason. We know he was a Mason. Matter of fact, I mean, I was just reading yesterday when he dedicated the cornerstone of the Capitol building, and of course the land where the Capitol building was built was donated by Daniel Carroll. The brother of John Carroll,
Mm-hmm.
When I even read this stuff, it startles me. I'd like to say, I mean, when you realize that these men, I'm talking about every single one of them, were not Christian. Now you cannot, somebody that's American, that's got patriotic blood, that's still hanging on to patriotism, they've got to hold on. And we got, like I said, a whole army. We got the David Barton movement, the wall builders. I mean, in other words, he takes guided tours through Washington, D.C. And, can you imagine, I always say this, here's David Barton, and again, Chris Pinto has a whole segment on David Barton. But David Barton, you know, talks around to churches all over the United States. Plus, he gives guided tours in Washington, D.C. What does a man say when he unloads a busload of people in front of the Washington Monument? You see,
what would he say if he unloaded the busload of tourists on Trafalgar Square in London and showed them the statue of George Washington with the fasces standing in Trafalgar Square?
Yes, that is very... what's that term, the hidden esoteric... it's hidden. In other words, the average person, like the average person that sees, how do you pronounce that square? Track?
Trafalgar Square.
Yes, yes. On the South Lawn,
Named after Trafalgar, I don't know, admiral or something.
Well, since you brought this up, let's see if we can explain this. Why Washington is there? He's on the South Lawn, and as a statue of him leaning up against a fascist symbol, and on the other side, in the North Lawn, is James II. In other words, when you understand, when I understood, you see, the people in the know understand why George Washington is there. They understand it, but the common person would, you know, well, they would think that they were paying tribute to George Washington, the first president of the United States. But James II, in 1887, you know, they tried to pass the Declaration of Indulgence. What it really was is a Declaration of Independence. It was saying that it was a freedom for religion, that all religions could, in other words, it only benefited one group, and that was the Catholics.
Of course.
But it arose such a stir in England that the average person is not going to understand what I'm saying now. But you got to do your research when you put in Glorious Revolution of 1888. Now, when the general public and the people, the nation arose up, that's why it's called the Glorious Revolution, is because not a bullet was fired, but there was so much opposition that it forced James II to leave the country. And then they put in William of Penn and Mary. I think that's his name. They put in a Protestant heir because James II had a Catholic wife and he'd become Catholic. And what he was doing, he was appointing, you know, the courts and all the military, he was appointing Catholics. And anyway, they caught wind of this and put so much heat on him that he went to France. And you have to ask yourself, this is very important to stop and think. Now, why would a king get up and leave the country? Because the reason he did is his daddy, Charles I, was executed for doing the same thing that he was trying to do. See? And so what happened? You have James II on the north lawn of the White House, or of the square in
Trafalgar Square in London. Yeah.
Yeah. You got James II on the South Lawn, no, the North Lawn. And in the South Lawn, you have George Washington. Well, this is what it signifies. This is what it signifies. What James II was unable to do with the Declaration of Indulgence, Washington was successful with.
James II was successful.
He was unsuccessful. They tried to pass the Declaration of Indulgence to give freedom of religion and take all the penal laws down so Catholics could worship, have all the powers and the civil power and as the Protestants. But that's what caused the revolution. The revolution caused so much stir that he had to leave because he was afraid of losing his head like his daddy. Now you have the Declaration of Indulgence by James II. Now you have the Declaration of 1687. And now you have the Declaration of Independence in 1776. What James II couldn't accomplish, Washington was successful with the Declaration of Independence. That's the American Revolution. See, in other words, all the Jesuits wanted all they wanted was that Declaration of Independence. I mean, this country, the only reason this country has never kicked the Jesuits out, and at that time, even in 1700, I mean, they'd been kicked out of many, many nations. And the only reason why they've never been kicked out of this country is because they run it.
Yeah, from the beginning.
From the very beginning. I mean, in other words, they didn't control every facet. Again, you had the, when people hear this, you say, well, Walt, you're anti-American. No, I love America. There's nothing wrong with America and the Constitution and the Bill of Rights. But you see, as soon as they opened the floodgates, that's why we have this country has the record we do. It's because of Rome and her Jesuits countering the Reformation. They started with the Counter-Reformation, with the American Revolution, and then the Civil War of 1860. That was another counter-reformation. I mean, this country has been under attack from its very inception. But the people, that's what made, I said it in the broadcast, and let me say it again, that's what made this country produce. That's why when I flew across the United States in 1977, and when you're in an airplane over Illinois, and you look 360 degrees, you see nothing but farm after farm after farm. Because they came over here, these Europeans came over here to escape religious persecution. And where were they getting all the heat? They were getting the heat from Rome. And they got over here This country, don't let me think I'm running this country down. This country's got something that no other country's got. We're citizens. In England, they're subjects. Another thing, this country, we had the right to own property. It wasn't until into the late 1900s with the income tax. And then they start, I don't forget what year they dropped the property tax, but that's what caused this. These people were Protestants. Listen, what made this country was not the government. It was the people. It was the Bible. The bottom line, it was the Word of God. The very enemy of our adversary, the Roman Catholic Church. It was the Bible that caused people read that Bible. And people don't obey laws. You can't legislate morality. Our morality came from the Word of God. And so people are listening to this broadcast. This is even heavy on me. Brothers and sisters, this is even heavy on me, the fact that it hurts me to see what's happened to this country and the complete takeover of the Roman Catholic Church with a Jesuit Pope coming to speak on his climate encyclical and going to his United Nations. Who do you think's behind the United Nations? The Jews? No, it's the Roman Catholic Church. It's Babylon. Merchants of the world. The Knights of Malta. You know, so I want to throw that in because people listen to the first two segments of this understand that Walt doesn't hate this country, and York and Walt don't have an agenda, a dangerous agenda. Yes, our agenda is dangerous to the Roman Catholic Church. What we're speaking here today is very dangerous to the Roman Catholic Church, but it's not dangerous. And listen, we're not dangerous to the people. We are God-fearing people. We believe in the Bible and the Bible alone, and we don't need a priest. We don't need somebody that calls himself the Vicar of Christ. The very word Vicar of Christ tells you who he is. He's the Antichrist. Yeah.
We have our own Vicar of Christ, the Holy Spirit.
Yes, yes, that's right. That's right. So anyway, we got another 15 minutes, but I think it's important, especially when it comes to Washington here, because this is painful for anybody that's listened to both segments. If this is not painful to learn some of this truth, then something's wrong with you.
Probably,
because this is painful to see what has happened to America right before my eyes. I mean, I'm a baby boomer, but I'm old enough to see the change, and to see what's transpired the last 2 weeks.
That's why they're just waiting for your generation to die off, Walt,
and the generation below. You know, I mean, there are two more generations, and they're not going to have any. I mean, and the only difference between right now is we still. I'm speaking. I'm my freedom of speech. I have freedom of speech, but there's going to be a time. They want to kill us. The world was not going to allow God's children to live. That's what the goal. That's what's going on. I listened to Fairdinkum Radio last night. I suggest all the listeners to go and listen to I forget the title. It's not the latest. It's this, you know. But I'm telling you, he was talking about the sodomite issue and what's going on in the multiculturalism. This is going on. They're doing the same thing to Europe. They did the same thing to Europe. It is Australia is making the multiculture, is melting us down. Because you see, when they fill this country or any country with Islam, that stamps out the Bible. See? And see, this country, what made this country, And what made this country produce was the Bible that the Protestant Reformation produced that because of the Reformation. I mean, it got into the average person's and people read it. This country was full of people morally, and they were surrounded by moral people. I grew up in my life around sound, moral people. But the generation growing up today has not had the opportunity that I've had. It's not their fault. But I appreciate you listening, because this is painful. This is painful even to make a broadcast on it, but it's the truth. It's the truth, and evidence does matter. So anyway, let's finish.
Nobody ever said that the truth was comforting.
No. Well, when you have the truth, you know, I have to admit,
it gives you comfort. Yeah,
it gives me comfort. I'm comforted. I mean, it's kind of sad. I mourn a little bit for what I see going on, But we that have the Bible, we have God's word, we are comforted. And there's a Bible passage, I can't quote it to you, but it says the exact same thing I just said. It's comforting to have God's word because we've got the truth. We can see through all of this deception, and to think that they're trying to push this sodomy over the all over. It's not just in America. There's 23 countries. I didn't realize that. There's 23 countries that have went sodomite. You know, but anyway, getting to George Washington, that's a very sensitive nerve on the false history that's been given to us Americans.
Sure is. So I continue reading now on page 122, the bottom. The following quotes comes from a relative of Asa Green named A.B. Bradford, which corroborates the account written in Jefferson's diary. In the quote, Bradford reveals what Asa Green told him. Quote, he explained more at length the plan that laid by the clergy of Philadelphia at the close of Washington's administration as president to get his views of religion for the sake of the good influence they supposed they would have in counteracting the infidelity of Paine and the rest of the revolutionary patriots, military and civil. But I well remember the smile on his face and the twinkle of his black eye when he said, "The old fox was too cunning for us." He affirmed, in concluding his narrative, that from his long and intimate acquaintance with Washington, he knew it to be the case that while he respectfully conformed to the religious customs of society by generally going to church on Sundays, he had no belief at all in the divine origin of the Bible or the Christian religion. End quote. This comes from Six Historic Americans by John E. Rimsburg, citing an article from the Chicago Tribune by B.F. Underwood. While the above quote is hearsay, it is absolutely in accord with the beliefs and words of Washington's revolutionary colleagues based on their own words in their own writings. Knowing that Washington was a Freemason should raise numerous red flags in the minds of Christians who understand that Freemasonry is the worship of Lucifer in its purest form, according to Albert Pike, if I may remind you, on his book Morals and Dogma, where he states that. In addition to all of the above evidence that clearly shows that our founding fathers were not Christians, there is the often forgotten Treaty of Tripoli from 1797, which states in no uncertain terms that the United States was not founded upon Christianity. And I have looked that up myself before and read the Treaty of Tripoli, and this is a very interesting and very intense. Listen. Article 11 of the Treaty of Tripoli states, quote, as the government of the United States of America is not in any sense founded on the Christian religion, as it has in itself no character of enmity against the laws, religion, or tranquility of Muslims, means Muslims, and as the said states never entered into any war or act of hostility against any Mahometan nation, it is declared by the parties that no pretext arising from religious opinions shall ever produce an interruption of the harmony existing between the two countries. Unquote. The Treaty of Tripoli tells us how it is concerning the question of whether or not the United States was founded upon Christianity. The treaty was anonymously approved in the Senate, and not a single person in the Senate objected to the wording of it. George Washington himself was the author of the Treaty of Tripoli, later approved under Adams' presidency. Quote, President Washington, the first time he ever came in... He ever came in treaty with a non-Christian people sent to the Senate, a treaty which opened with the following, quote, as the government of the United States of America is not in any sense founded on the Christian religion, unquote. There is the statement from the great Washington, unquote. And this comes from Moncure D. Conway, Addresses and Reprints, 1850 to 1907, page 347. The Bible-believing Christians of the time knew what was going on. They knew the revolutionaries were a bunch of crooks and frauds. Unlike today's Christians, who have swallowed the lie that the men who founded this country were godly men who loved Jesus Christ. Christian Dr. Bert Wilson wrote about the truth of the matter in the early 1800s. Quote, "The founders of our nation were nearly all infidels. When the war was over, the Constitution was framed and God was neglected. He was not merely forgotten, he was absolutely voted out of the Constitution. The proceedings as published by Thompson, the secretary, shows that the question was gravely debated whether God should be in the Constitution or not, and after a solemn debate, he was deliberately voted out of it." End quote. Dr. Bert Wilson, as cited by G.E. Rimsberg, Six Historic Americans, page 120. Walt, I want to bring it here to an end because I think this last paragraph that I read is something that we can start a very good discussion on the next time that we go on the broadcast here. We have today made this in three parts. I want to close it up. Do you have anything, any closing remarks before I close the broadcast, Walt?
Well, I think, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Can you, I think we could read that last paragraph, though. That's just a, and we could read it again the next time, see?
Yeah, we can read it next time. That's what I meant. This is a nice way to close the broadcast for today, but we will start with this on our next broadcast if we go into it again, because this is really something that people should understand in the right way.
But I want to leave us with this. He says, our founding fathers did not take a stand for Jesus Christ because they did not believe in Jesus Christ as God. Nowhere in the Declaration of Independence or Constitution is Jesus' name ever mentioned. I can assure you that the God of our founders is not the God of the Bible. Could it be any clearer from their own writings?
I don't think so.
The God written on our money is not the God of the Bible either. It was two Freemasons who had the Egyptian symbolism of the pyramid and eye on the back of the $1 bill. That is an occult symbolism and has nothing to do with Jesus Christ. The eye above the pyramid on the eye out of the Egyptian sun god, Osiris. Osiris is the equivalent of the Babylonian sun god, Nimrod. Both of these sun gods are the equivalent of the human intellect, or Lucifer. I encourage you to release yourself from the world's political system. Take comfort in the safety of Christ. Man is not going to build anything, any way. Man is not going to build another way to heaven. This is what the Babylonians tried to do as they erected their towers in the heavens, saying, let us make a name for ourselves. The Babylonians of today who control politics are trying to do the same thing. This is not the way, brethren. The kingdom of his God is within you, and it is everlasting. I think the man did a tremendous job, and I just wanted to, because his last paragraph was his best paragraph. I mean, that's the best. I mean, because he had to talk about all the negative about these founders, but they weren't. The bottom line is they were not Christians. So we could close it from here.
Okay. That was a good ending statement, Walt. Thank you very much for your contribution to the program today and bringing this book that you put together, this booklet of the Vatican Jesuit Global Conspiracy to the table. Very interesting. The deeper we get into it, the better it gets. And I want to thank everybody for attending the broadcast today and listening to our show. Whether is it via the internet or watching the video that I will make of this in Juggler 66. Thank you very much for listening, for your attention, and until the next time, God bless you, and bye-bye.